Well, I'm encouraged to see such a full house on this holiday week. I hope you all have enjoyed a little bit of rest and celebration this week. And I look forward to celebrating our faith today with you this morning. Last week, I also was privileged with leading the worship, but I forgot, as I guess it's a 50-50 chance that I will remember to do the breathing exercise that Pastor Gay has successfully established as part of our worship service. So I want to invite you now to do as we do most every Sunday, and to just close your eyes, to place your right hand over your heart, your left hand on your belly, and to breathe in very slowly to the count of four. And out to the count of more than four. Breathe in once again. And out, releasing the tensions and anxieties of the week. And one more time, breathing in to prepare ourselves to receive the Holy Spirit. And out, releasing the breath, and ready to begin our worship service. I invite our acolyte to bring the light of the world into our Sunday morning service.
Would you please join me in the call to worship? O divine voice, you sing and the universe comes to being.
O divine breath, you breathe and all things spring to life.
Divine word, you call and creation is sustained.
O divine flesh, you are born of goodness and the creator is full of
O Divine Spirit, you contain all that has been formed.
O Divine Light, you are the cause of all that is.
In faith and expectation, in wonder and celebration,
we gather to remember
this. In you, all things live and move and have being. Please join me in an opening prayer. O God, who gives birth to all that we see, all that we know, all that we dream, and all that we have unseen, unto imagining, celebrating life and the whole nurtured universe. We celebrate your love, which joins you. We give thanks for your life, which is incarnated in Christ, which is in every creation. We savor your presence within us and welcome you, and your spirit will fill every moment of time and every fragment of matter. Amen.
Friends, hear these words of assurance. Even as we receive again God's vision of life, we recognize that we have been blind to its universal heartbeat. Even as we remember the connectedness of all things, we acknowledge that we have divided and separated ourselves and forgot our part in God's creation. Even as we are energized by the holy breath within us, we confess our destructiveness and repent of the harm we have done to ourselves and to our world. And yet we are blessed by God's forgiveness and grace. Amen.
How are all of you? Let's do that hand in my hand. Water bottles. What do we use water bottles for? To drink. What two ways that you're thinking about these water bottles? Right. And what's the other way? That's a trigger. You take your cap off and you can pull it. That kind of repeats spot, but there's two different ways. So those are ways you can think, if we wanted to refill the bottles, could we refill them the same two ways? Just one way? Well, actually, you could try two ways. The lesson I was working on told me to do it here. I didn't want to do it on the church. I didn't think the church would appreciate it. So I did it at home. One of the bottles, I opened this and I counted to 8 as I put the spigot and filled it this way. Then this one, I took the cap off, counted to 8, and filled it. Now I bet you already know which one has more water. The one that I opened up and filled completely. The other one, actually it did get some water in, it's about today. And the other one is all the way to the top. So in our lesson on the mark today, we're going to kind of, Jesus has a story, we're going to kind of talk about, we're going to pretend these water bottles are crowns. So the first crown we're going to think about is the one here that you just open this and fill. And so that crown is going to represent Jesus' hometown. So in the story, we hear Jesus' hometown wasn't very excited about him. And because they weren't very excited about him, Jesus was not able to pour very much of God's love, his hope, and healing into the town. So this followed kind of like Jesus' town. They were closed off, and they couldn't get much of the God's love in. Then later in the story, they talk about the other towns that the disciples go to, and they had the caps off, so they were open to all of Jesus's, all of the love and hope and healing in those places. Those towns were like the bottle with the lid off. They opened up and were ready to be filled. So if we think about the two bottles the same way we think about the towns, the only difference of them is the choice of whether to have the lid closed or the lid open. Even though we're not a town, I want to say I'm very thankful that we are a part of this congregation where every week we gather together and remind each other that we want to be like this bottle, but with the lid off, so that we can be filled with God's hope, healing, and filled with love and healing. So that when we are filled with this hope and healing, that we can go and have hope, feeling to share with others. Can you pray with me? Dear Jesus, thank you for, dear God, thank you for Jesus and his disciples who kept offering your love and healing to all who would receive it. Help us to do the same so that we can then share your love and healing with others. In Jesus' name.
Our first lesson comes from Prophet Ezekiel, chapter 2, verse 1 through 5. Listen as the Spirit speaks to the church. A voice said, "Son of man, stand up. I have something to say to you." The moment I heard the voice, the Spirit entered me and put me on my feet. As he spoke to me, I listened. He said, "Son of man, I'm sending you to the family of Israel, a rebellious nation, if there ever was one. They and their ancestors have fomented rebellion right up to the present. They are a hard case. These people to whom I'm sending you to harden in their sins. Tell them, this is the message of God, the Master. They are a defiant bunch. Whether or not they listen, at least they'll know that the prophet's been here. May God bless the reading and hearing of the holy words."
A reading from the New Testament in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, verses 1 through 6. Now hear these words. He left there and returned to his hometown. His disciples came along. On the Sabbath, he gave a lecture in the meeting place. He stole the show, impressing everyone. "We had no idea he was this good," they said. "How did he get so wise all of a sudden? Such ability." But in the next breath, they were cutting him down. "He's just a carpenter, Mary's boy. We've known him since he was a kid. We know his brothers, James, Justice, Jude, and Simon, and his sisters. Who does he think he is?" They tripped over what little they knew about him and fell, sprawling. And they never got any further. Jesus told them, "A prophet has little honor in his hometown, among his relatives, on the streets he played in as a child." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Been told, so now you Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight. Most people think great God will come from the sky, take away everything and make everybody feel high. But if you know what life is worth, you will look for yours on earth. And now you see the light, you stand up for your right. Jump, get up, stand up. Jump, jump, stand up for your right. Get up, stand up.
Get up, stand up.
Don't give up the fight.
Life is your right.
Get up, stand up.
We can't give up the fight.
Stand up for your right.
Lord, Lord,
get up, stand up.
Keep us traveling on.
Don't give up the fight.
Yeah.
You're sick and tired of your ism, schism, game, time, and go to heaven in Jesus' name, Lord. We know and we understand, Almighty God is a living man. You can fool some people sometimes, but you can't fool other people all the time. So now we see the light.
What you gonna,
we gonna stand up for?
Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah,
you better get up,
stand up
in the morning.
Give it up,
stand up for your life.
Stand up.
Don't give up the fight.
Don't give it up, don't give it up.
Get up, stand up.
Get up, stand up.
Stand up for your right.
Get up, stand up.
Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight.
Get up, stand up.
Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right.
Join me in just a moment of prayer, please. Holy One, in this brief time on a Sunday morning, we have prepared ourselves through prayer and through song, through silent reflection, to receive and consider your word. Help us now, Lord. Help us to respond, as did the ancient prophet Ezekiel, to your call to stand up and to receive the commission that you bring to us through Jesus Christ. Amen. So this song that was played just before the reflection is one from 1973. Some of you were around in 1973, I think, and maybe you even remember when Bob Marley and the Wailers released their album, Burnin', including this song, Get Up, Stand Up. And I like this particular recording because all of the verses are laid out in placards and banners, not unlike the many that we saw on the streets around the world and in the United States at that time. Bob Marley wrote this song with Peter Tosh, another member of the band. It was a reggae band that was birthed out of the foment, the social justice, I would say, that was being witnessed in Jamaica. And these two writer musicians were also members of the religion in that society, in that culture, called Rastafari. And that brings me around to how this music of my youth found its way into my own kind of stream of consciousness. The Rastafari religion, you may not have heard of it, but it's a Bible-based religion, as well as a social movement that developed in Jamaica, where the Wailers are from, in the early 20th century. That should sound familiar to folks in the UCC tradition. Rasta folks also hold that God partially resides within each individual. The music of Bob Marley is iconic. It represents both the Jamaican reggae style and the nonviolent protest approach of many social justice advocates at the time. Coming up in the 1960s and 70s, this permeated my experience of the world, and I'm sure it did for many of you as well. And, of course, it was pretty easy to dance to. I think that this song is a classic for our world today as well. The opening words resonate for our times. Stand up for your rights. Get up, stand up, don't give up the fight. And that refrain, as you heard, repeats throughout the performance. Now, I think we all agree that civil rights represents an ongoing movement in the United States. But believe it or not, way back in the 1970s, it found stiff competition with political scandal, with war abroad, and with the then emergent climate crisis. Sound familiar? Worldwide, however, people began to see the reports of the civil rights movement in the United States, and as an indication that Western civilization had finally woken up to the realities faced by various groups in all places for generations. What we were experiencing here at that time resonated deeply in communities all over the world. But there were those in our country for whom social justice advocacy of the sort central to the Rasta movement and many others in the Third World did not resonate so deeply. In the wake of two world wars and a depression, many Christian denominations in our country were not so much interested in social justice advocacy as they were in just plain socializing. Some good Christian folks were even invested in active opposition to civil rights, to women's rights, to voters' rights, to workers' rights, to human rights of all kinds. You might find reports of such opposition among religious groups of our time. But this morning I want to cycle back a few thousand years, that's all, to the time of the Babylonian exile, the time of the prophet Ezekiel. If ever there were issues of social justice ignored, it was then. The people of faith of Israel had become pawns in the ongoing conflict between the Babylonian Empire and Egypt. Persian armies prevailed in Palestine. Jewish leadership was removed from Jerusalem, exiled to Babylon, and many of the holy city's citizens fled to the countryside. Among the leaders who were taken was Ezekiel. Ezekiel was both a priest and a prophet for the people of faith, but his prophetic calling became a most profound influence during this time. The biblical book bearing his name is full of oracles or visions for the people of faith in exile, visions of the homeland, of foreign nations, of judgment, and of restoration. The passage we have heard this morning represents Ezekiel as a called representative of God. Thus, the prophetic presence is introduced. It is important to note that as a priest, Ezekiel's orientation to God was as other, that is, human relationship with God was one of submission to a sovereign judgment, not unlike the position of Israel to Babylon. They were subordinate. The prophet's interpretation of the exilic situation was full of holy judgment. Quote, "They're a hard case, these people to whom I'm sending you." But in the passage for today, my attention was drawn to something else. It's a relatively minor reference, perhaps, but I don't think it's insignificant. And I'm referring to what happens when, in a vision, the voice of God commands Ezekiel, "Son of man, stand up. I have something to say to you." And Ezekiel responds, "The moment I heard the voice, the Spirit entered me and put me on my feet." Remember how I said at the time, the temple priest's orientation to God was one of other, outside of him or herself, not me? Here is a pivotal moment, a change in the consciousness of the people of faith. And it strikes me as curious that here Ezekiel has an interior experience of the divine, and he responds by jumping up to his feet, alert to God's command. In case you're planning to go home and check me out on all of this and read the book of Ezekiel, I have a spoiler alert. It concludes with a vision of the city of Jerusalem, its inhabitants, and the temple restored. That's the good news. But there's certainly much more good news for the people of faith of Israel, and it goes on for millennia. To be sure, there is much not so good news in the mix as well, but the nation survives to this date. And while orthodoxy may concur with God as other theology, God with us theology, you know that God with us phrase, don't you? God with us theology permeates the history of God's people. There is much progressive thinking to indicate that human initiative has played and continues to play a role in the justice that has been revealed for Israel and for many other communities in the world. What I want to say is this: whenever and whatever humans gather, issues of authority and trust, obedience and justice mark our struggle to stay together. Being together, struggling together, is basic to being human and to being in community. This has been made abundantly clear for us in our own times. Social justice is still far from secure for God's children. And as a community of faith, like the prophet Ezekiel, we are called to get up, to stand up. God has something to say to us. In the good news message today, when some locals gathered to hear an itinerant preacher bring a word to the Temple of Nazareth, they experienced exhilaration in the gathering. As a people of faith, they looked forward to hearing the word of God. And after his teaching, they said, "We had no idea he was this good. And how did he get so wise all of a sudden, get such ability?" Yet they struggled with their belief that God was other than them and that the preacher said otherwise, and then they responded, "He's just a carpenter, Mary's boy. We've known him since he was a kid. We know his brothers, his sisters. Who does he think he is?" I'm thinking that the Rastafari orientation to God would have been a help to those folks when Jesus came home to preach. If only then they had been able to feel the holiness in his teaching and in his person, they might never have heard him say, "A prophet has little honor in his hometown, among his relatives, on the streets where he played as a child." But you know, and this remains true to this day, you can only meet people where they are. And sometimes, like Ezekiel, you meet a hard case. They turn in, even as God is out. Over the centuries since Ezekiel's prophetic voice was heard, some Jewish communities prohibited the reading of his book by anyone under 30 years old. You're still safe, Ernie. It's true. Over the centuries, people under 30 were not allowed to read the book of Ezekiel. It was deemed too controversial for the young mind. Full of exotic places, disturbing visions, dangerous missions. Truth be told, the call to justice not only incited the younger ones, it made the older folks uncomfortable. Can you imagine that? I believe that with the power of the Holy Spirit within, we are all old enough to receive Ezekiel's prophecy and Jesus' preaching. In faith, we are mature enough to withstand the urge to ignore the injustices of our time. We are old enough and strong enough to get up and stand up for all of God's creation. Let us prepare ourselves by locating the holy within. Recall the ways that the Spirit has lifted you personally, and for those who know this congregation as a whole, to stand up for what's right. And let it shine, you people of God. Let your faith shine. Tell the story to one another. Get up and stand up and let the holy in you be a testimony to God's love and justice for all of God's people. And never give up the fight. Let all God's people say, Amen.
Our loving God has called us into the nation film around us to show our brothers and sisters what his love looks like. May the gifts we offer today be fueled for the fire that burns within us, igniting our desire to be your worker. Our morning offering will now be received. Please join me in prayer of dedication. Merciful God, accept our gifts, we pray, and bless for now this morning's offering, that we might do your will in this place and in all the world. Amen.
Join me now in a time of prayer. Holy One, we gather here this morning and bring with us the joys and the concerns of the world, each of us a witness, each of us a witness to the trials, the tribulations, the joys and celebrations that we experience in a lifetime. Each of us seeking to be instruments of your peace in the world. And so, Lord, we open ourselves up. And we know that we might submit to you the names of those who are dear to us, that we may offer these up in prayer for each to hear and for your care. Lord, we submit to you the names of Mark Reeves' family, of Gloria, Betsy, and Brian, of Pastor Gay. Lord, in your mercy. Kristen Robeson, Jim Kuhn, Ava, Julia, Kathy, Jean Grigalunas, Lois, Bud, and Lucy. Lord, in your mercy. The family of Amy Cunningham, Jeff and LaShawn Rice, Virginia Dillon, Roger Henley's family. Lord, in your mercy. Gabby McCall, Kim, Michelle, Tim, Bev Sedlak, family of Jeanette Roach, Barbara. Lord, in your mercy. Margaret, Tim Fuller, Bud, Paul, Paula Lynn, Norma, Irv and Jerry, the family of Kathy Yoho. Lord, in your mercy. Ernie, Mark, Rick, Ellie Finley, Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, we submit our prayers as well for all those who protect us. Lord, in your mercy. Holy One, you sent to us a teacher, a friend, a savior, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, we begin each month at this table. This is Christ's table. He is the host. It is he who invites us, and all who seek Christ's transforming presence are welcome to joy in sharing communion, regardless of religious affiliation. May the Lord be with you. May your hearts be lightened and filled with God's love. We praise God, we thank God, come rain and come shine, We thank God, we praise God, Creator Divine. It is right and it is good, it's blessed and joyful to give thanks to you, God Almighty and Faithful. For it's you that has given us this worship time, filled with laughter, filled with holy humor and rhyme. It's you that has shown us your holy love that you sent from heaven so high above. Holy God, it's your Son we remember today, Jesus Christ, the Anointed, whom we try to obey. He encouraged the poor and he freed the oppressed, and he taught us that you care about the distressed. Through his suffering, death, and then resurrection, he taught that your grace beats out our imperfection. He rose up to heaven and sits beside you, but he still remains with us in all that we do. On the night that he was taken, he lifted some bread. He blessed it. He broke it. And then here's what he said. Dear friends, it's my body to you that I give. Here, take it and share it. In you I will live. From now on, whenever, wherever you meet, when remember the time when this bread you did eat. And when the supper was over, he took the cup, and with praise and thanksgiving, he lifted it up. For the new covenant offered you from above, my blood is a sign of God's unending love. Yes, the Lord has forgiven your every mistake, so then trust in God's love when this drink you partake. May we offer ourselves new for God's greater glory and pronounce what we know of this wonderful story. Christ Jesus, he died and then rose again. He returned to us here. Alleluia. Amen. Holy Spirit, fall upon us in this sacred space with this bread and this fruit of the vine all in place. Make holy this food, fill us with your grace, and we will proclaim to the whole human race, we love you, Lord Jesus, we shout out again, your glory and honor, amen and amen. Friends, this meal has been prepared with you in mind. We will invite you to come forward as you are willing and able. And if you are not, remain seated and raise your hand and we'll come to you. We will serve you the bread and the cup, invite you to take your portion back to your seat. And when all have received, we will all take each together. Come now, for all things are prepared. Thank you. This is Christ's body broken for you. Take and eat. God's new promise in Christ's blood. Take and drink. Thank you, sir. You please join me in our unison prayer of dedication and thanksgiving. Generous God, take our gifts this day and use them so that we may be part of your great work in this world. Through our giving, bring a brighter day of justice and love, not just in our community, but in the world beyond these walls. Strengthen our church and the whole United Church of Christ so that we grow together each day into a powerful voice for healing and peace. Thank you, Lord, for your invitation to this holy meal. Help us always to remember the one we have met here and what we have received from him. Remind us, too, of all the other guests at this table and what we share with one another. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, our closing hymn, I'm going to try to do this a cappella. I'm going to rely heavily on each and every one of you to join me. It's a kind of a call and response hymn where I will call and you will respond in kind. What I'd like to do is rehearse your line first, and then we'll begin the hymn. Okay, you sing like this. Send me Jesus, send me Jesus, send me Jesus, send me Lord. Send me Jesus, send me Jesus, send me Jesus, send me Lord. Is that key okay? Forrest, is that key okay for you? I know you kind of low down there. Ernie, are you good? All right. Let's try it one more time. Send me Jesus. Send me Jesus. Send me Jesus. Send me, Lord. Send me Jesus. Send me Jesus. Send me Jesus. Send me, lead me, Lord, lead me, Jesus, lead me, Jesus, lead me, Jesus, lead me, fill me, Lord, fill me, Jesus, fill me, Jesus, fill me, Jesus, fill me, Lord, send me, Jesus. Send me Jesus, send me Jesus, send me Lord. Wonderful. Next time we'll do it with the Latin. Now I want to invite our acolyte to come forward and to bring out the light of the world.